Hey, welcome back. 15 years of your Flying Colours album. When you started all the way back then, what was the hope? What was the dream? What did you set out to achieve?
I think we were living the dream, right?
Yeah.
We just wanted to be able to create music, and if we can somehow make a living off it, wonderful. So it all was just bonuses after that.
Yeah, I don't think we actually, like, in our heads it was kind of like, to start rapping in Australia, like, when back then, like, if you think about, like, the hurdles we had to jump through now, it seems like almost like we were kidding ourselves, but I think we had to have a little bit of that almost foolishness to think we could do it. Mm. And if without that, I don't think we would have succeeded, because it was kind of that blind faith, you know what I mean? And we just stuck to our guns and just kept going.
Here's a question. You know? When did you know that you'd made it?
Oh, it was a slow progression. I remember the first time my parents walked into one of our first sold-out shows at Horton Pavilion. And that was, like, the first moment they kind of looked at me like, this ain't a hobby, is it?
Yeah. Like, when you can quit your 9-to-5, when you don't have to be a carny down at Luna Park anymore.
It was, is that what you did?
He used to sell our mixtapes to the people getting on the roller coaster.
Play it on the ride.
That's actually quite cool. It's like you're being a man on the inside. Yeah.
Captive audience.
Mm. I don't want to show off, but I travel a lot. And I feel like it doesn't matter where you go in this country, you guys are playing a gig there. I see your name everywhere. Do you owe people money? You don't stop touring.
It's crazy. And it started off just like literally grinding it out in my little hatchback, driving around the country, playing for like 10-20 people.
Six people sometimes.
Wow. You know, but we would make these mixtapes on like a 2-speed CD burner with like a photocopy piece of paper as the cover, and we'd throw them out at gigs, and like that was literally meeting every fan one by one, and that's how we built it.
Had to hustle it back
then.
Was
it like 6 people, but 2 of them were your parents?
I'm sure that would have been the case. Absolutely. Hey, Mum.
Has touring gotten easier over the years? Like, is it just you know your thing, it's a well-oiled machine, you're so used to it now?
It's just fun, yeah. And it's like you still get that excitement, do you know what I mean? Because it's like as soon as you step out on stage, it's like all these people are here to rock with you, and like you see the passion on their faces, and they're spitting the lyrics that you wrote with all your heart back at you with more passion than you had when you wrote it. Yeah. So it's like it's just a beautiful thing, and it's just connecting through energy and music, and it's like
And our crowds are crazy.
Oh, they're crazy. We have the best fans ever.
Like how crazy?
I did a crowd surf once. And I injured my hand. Yeah. This is what my thumb does now. You got a good look at this?
Yeah, oh. I can't see it. Oh, no.
Oh, my God. You've been playing that all night.
I have a good reaction.
Are you okay? Yeah. You obviously can't hitchhike.
It's actually
anymore.
Double jointed, oh. Which was actually one of my first rap names. I was going to be double jointed, always doing that. And...
You've seen that a lot of times.
I've seen it many times. Yeah. He also jumped off of a balcony after a gig one time, broke his arm, and we had to go play this in Kilderfest the next day.
That was all on the Flying Colours tour as well.
Yeah, it was. It was indeed. Yeah.
Clearly, you're both, you know, you're resilient individuals. We've been talking about survivalists tonight and how long you could survive in the wild. Mm. How would you go if you were like plonked out in nature?
I'd like to think I would be amazing.
Yeah.
But no. I mean,
nature clearly would love your party trick.
Yes.
Yeah, you'd be scaring bears with that thing.
I'd like to think I can last out there.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Would you?
Tricks.
I have no idea, really. You're going to throw me out and see how we go. But, yeah. Yeah.
Are you glad that 15 years later, since you started, you didn't have to battle back then TikTok and algorithms, or do you think that actually makes it a bit easier for artists?
Well, you know what? It's an interesting question, because there's two sides to it, right? When we started, there wasn't the internet. And the internet is a great tool now. You can basically record and produce an album all in your bedroom. You can market it all from your bedroom, your social media, everything. But with that comes a lot more competition, right? Because everyone has the capability to do it. Whereas when we started, we had to forge our own way and figure out a roadmap when there was no map, especially coming from here, right? So we had to do the hard yards, like I said, in the hatchback, grinding it out. So it's like I'm happy that we kind of had that experience building it how we did, because it gives us an appreciation of where we are now. And also, like, we've built this fan base over time. With Flying Colours was probably our first album that really resonated really, really deeply with people. And, you know, 15 years later, here we are, and it's almost a sold-out tour, you know, like, and that's incredible. So it's a beautiful thing, man. I mean, the beautiful gift about music is when you connect with people, right? Mm. Through lyrics, when you have, see tattoos of your lyrics on people's skin, where they tell you a story about a time in their life, and that's like the soundtrack to their life or a moment in time. You know, it's a beautiful thing.
Well, I reckon you've sold a few more tickets with the party trick. Mm. Tickets to Bliss and SO's huge Fire and Colours 15-year anniversary tour are selling fast. All the info on our website. Would you please thank Bliss?
Yeah.